Ladies and gentlemen, we're going to start our public meeting. I'm Mike Whitehill. I'm the project administrator for the Maryland Heritage Area Grant. We have at the table the committee that was assembled by the town council, which is our steering committee for this project. And I'd like to have each of you introduce yourselves, starting with Royden and work your way to me. Well, actually, probably start with Scott, since you're one of the presenters.
Oh, well, Elizabeth, do you want to start since we're...
Yes.
Yeah, let's do that.
Two consultants.
That's all right.
I'm Elizabeth Watson with Heritage Strategies, and we are the lead consulting firm. And my colleague here is Scott.
My name is Scott Scarfone, principal landscape architect with Oasis Design Group. And we're fulfilling the role on the project of urban design and planner.
Good evening. I'm Royden Powell. I'm from Centreville, and I'm representing the Queen Anne's Railroad Society, given that part of the heritage focus was on railroad transportation. Pleased to be a part of the group.
Mm-hmm. And I'm Mary Margaret Revelle Goodwin, and I'm doing the history and the signs for the trail.
I'm Lou Armstrong, and I'm a new guy in town. I've only lived here for 40 years, and I am on the board of the Corsica River Conservancy.
Hi, my name is Laura Sanford. I live in Centerville, and I work for the Eastern Shoreland Conservancy.
The purpose of our meeting today is to go over the preliminary first shot results of our work that started probably back in original grant application was way back around 2010, probably even before. Through a series of events, that grant was postponed. But it was kept alive by a series of extensions, and we're very grateful to the Maryland Heritage Authority for keeping that grant alive. When we revived it, several things had significantly changed. We had always wanted to do a fair amount of work with the railroad. The building that was originally there, the old depot building, which between the time that the grant was made and the time we actually got around to doing the work, had been moved to the Bloomfield farm. So we had several other changes that happened, which actually I think were fortuitous, because over time that allowed the town to sort of mature its thinking a little bit on how that grant might be best applied. We have two primary points of focus with the heritage area. One is in rail and transportation, and how that was furthered the growth of agriculture, transportation, and other purposes. And of course, then we had the wharf, which was a very strong component in the midshore for the transportation of grain, for bringing the arts in as the floating opera, in the form of a floating opera, and for many, many other things that the wharf did for bringing in fuels and other fertilizers and so on. So we ended up with two spots that we thought ought to be linked together somehow by an intelligent look at Centreville's past with an eye to Centreville's future. The councils, various councils, and this one in particular, had been concerned that we wanted to establish, if possible, some economic development benefit out of this grant, so that there might be some way to attract visitors to the town, keep them, feed them, house them, and send them home with a good experience. In order to do that, we had to figure out a means to cohesively connect the Pennsylvania Avenue Railroad property with the wharf property, and do it in a manner that people visiting the town would have a full day's experience walking from one venue to the next, using the streets of Centreville along the way and the Millstream Park as means to that end. And that also gave rise to the notion that the downtown, which this heritage trail must perforce cross, would have an interest in being here to talk to advance the cause of developing the downtown while people were in town, and take any possible advantage from the target investment zone and other things that had been done previously, which I'm sure Elizabeth will speak to. So with the TIS in place, with a fairly active business community, and with these two lovely pieces of property that are town-owned property, For whom the town council and its assignees have stewardship to bring those to life in the most logical fashion. So we started. We thought that having members of the railroaders, the Queen Anne's got actually a pretty robust, vigorous railroading group, a very enthusiastic group of railroaders, would be great to have on the committee. And then, of course, over time, there have been various wharf committees that people would look at the wharf to see if there were things that could be done down there. Not to set up a draconian schedule of land use that was going to become codified, but rather to find those uses through public meeting and input from you all, the kind of uses that might go on there, so that over time, as we become more grant-worthy and as we find resources, we would be able to intelligently spend those resources developing these pieces of property, both for the benefit of the town, but also for the benefit of the individuals coming to visit. So with that, in our initial planning, we thought that it would probably be good to take a look at the Pennsylvania Railroad property and work our way downhill, in some sense. And I think that's kind of where we'd like to go. We want to focus our attention first on the railroad property, then on the wharf property, and then on the links that naturally have to occur to create a walkable, enjoyable trail in between the two. So, Scott, do you want to start with the Pennsylvania Avenue property?
Sure. Thank you. So, I guess it was 3 weeks ago, 4 weeks ago, we had a day-long walkthrough. Many of you participated in that. We walked through town, we looked at the sites, we looked at roads. Oh, I'm sorry. Excuse me.
Sorry, should I start again?
Please.
Okay. So about 2 or 3 weeks ago, we had a day-long walkthrough. 8 hours we spent in town walking around the various sites, looking at other amenities, other cultural attractions in town, meeting with various folks, really just kind of getting a handle on the lay of the land, but really mainly listening to people talk about the site's histories, both sites, and what their desires might be, but also a little bit about what's happening in town. And that really began to inform our work anyways, because both of the sites were given to us as sort of open-ended. The town had some sort of conceptual ideas of what they thought they might like to see, but there was no definitive direction in terms of a program. So there was a combination of things that we used to kind of feed us as we went through and came up with some design recommendations, and that was any past studies that may have been done that looked at these sites, sort of suggesting some uses, then we'll talk about those. Some current thoughts from various community members in terms of what they might like to see there, what they think would be successful, either in terms of a programmatic use or economically viable, which mostly applies to the railroad property. And then just people's personal preference of what they think they might like to see as someone who lives in town or knows people that actively participate in town activities. That, in combination of kind of our experience of dealing with sites in similar nature, throughout the state, we then took all that, melded that together, and basically came up with two alternative concepts that we're going to present to you this evening that shows potential development scenarios, and I say development lightly, you'll see what I mean in the wharf site, but transformative scenarios of either site. This is, as Mike said, this is our first blush. This is us translating your ideals. Also, we have to caveat the fact that this is a very sort of fast-tracked project with an incredibly tight budget. So the passes are relatively quick, but I will say that they are very thoughtful. So with that in mind, we'll start with the railroad property. And I want to take you back to, I guess it was 2010. There was a study that was done on the railroad property. And Mike, fill in the blanks if I miss something here. Forgive me, because I don't have all the history kind of memorized. But this study was done looking at the south side of Pennsylvania Avenue. This is Pennsylvania Avenue, of course, the new development. This is the former, that was a PNC Bank, correct? Mm-hmm. Former PNC Bank. And this is the current vacant site, which if you've been out there recently, you see that there's a whole bunch of big, heavy equipment and a lot of storm pipe that's laying there under construction right now. So this side of Pennsylvania Avenue was successfully developed, and I have to applaud all of you for whoever was involved with that, because it looks spectacular. You kept the character, the architecture looks nice, the size of the building fits in with the scale of the community. You really did a nice job, and what's even nicer to see is the fact that pretty much all of those facilities have businesses in them. So that was impressive. So this study, and actually there's the gentleman who did that back in the back corner, not to point you out, but it was a good study, and the focus back then was essentially to look at retail. So the thinking at that time, and quite frankly, the thinking all the way up to where when we had our walkthrough, was to use retail for this site. The other big issue for this site was parking. We understood that there was a certain requirement for parking that had to be met to accommodate some of these businesses over here. So parking really was a big issue. So the challenge, in our opinion, and I'm kind of teeing up the two concepts that we're going to present to you, we saw two problems with retail. First of all, the parking ratio required for retail or office operations is significantly higher than other types of uses, mainly residential. The site is very small, so there's a problem right there. There is also a perceived problem of a lack of parking in town, when the reality is what we found out from walking through town and talking with people, there really isn't a parking issue. It's just a perception of maybe parking isn't quite at my front door, which is fairly typical. People just are basically fundamentally lazy and they want to park right in front of their front door. So it's our understanding through our observations that there is no parking issue. But so that being said, the other thing that we observed with retail was as we walked through town and we spoke with the woman, forgive me, I don't know, recall her name, in charge of the Main Street program.
Carol D'Agostino.
Yeah. There's a lot of vacant stores out there. A lot of problems keeping merchants in town for lack of traffic, lack of economic volume. So there really, in our observation, is not a need for retail. And that is sort of anecdotal. The challenge with that is simply our observations as an outsider, listening to people and observing. We were not able to find any definitive economic study that was done to, you know, confirm our assessment. So we're going to kind of hang our hat on that, and we're going to shift gears and make a recommendation outside of retail, which we'll show to you now. So does everyone know what we're looking at here? This is a site plan superimposed over an aerial photograph. This is Pennsylvania Avenue. Again, the former PNC Bank, which is vacant currently. So what we're proposing that the town consider is appropriate land use are residential. And we're gonna suggest two different types of residential approaches to you. Again, the parking requirements for residential are significantly less than retail. So that's one way to nip the parking issue. The other thing is, obviously anecdotally, we heard of the storefront issue, the retail issue, but also we heard that there is a lack of small quality rental housing or new housing that's in town. And we heard that some of the landlords that have some of the older buildings maybe up there in their years or aren't really doing the investment to keep the housing stock, rental housing stock, up to standard. So we feel that there's a real opportunity for new housing in the core of downtown. So in this particular scheme, there's really sort of several things happening here. First is we heard a very strong desire, the need to commemorate in some fashion the historic use of that site, which dealt with the railroad. We also know that eventually this will sort of act as a trailhead to a Rails to Trail project that will come up and basically terminate at this point. So on this particular scheme, we showed an L-shaped park or open space that will have some small gateway or entrance plaza along this road right here. We also heard someone suggested a really good idea that you get a train, a caboose, an engine, or something like that, and have that at the site. And so that would serve as a demarcation for the entrance to this little pocket park, but also give you an opportunity from an interpretive, from a heritage standpoint, to interpret the history of the site and celebrate that as a commemorative site. Because the site is fairly long and narrow, it's actually quite difficult to deal with. There's not a lot of opportunities to deal with that. So usually when we find a site like that, you don't fight it. You work with the configuration of the site. So we're suggesting that there would be a promenade, a walkway. All kinds of things could be done with that. We're suggesting that tracks get laid into the pavement. You can also do a history walk, where the pavement is embedded with various history markers. I mean, there's all kinds of things that could be done to this park. You know, that's a whole next level of design that, you know, we're just not involved with at this level. But there's all kinds of things that you can do from an interpretive and historic commemorative standpoint along here. This would then terminate. On this one, we actually have the train caboose here. Forgive me, the other one has the train caboose here. We'll see in a minute. And then on this leg, we tried to pick up, if you notice on these, if you've driven down Pennsylvania, you notice that there were these little sort of open spaces that were created in between these buildings, these little sort of vacant, you know, not vest pocket sort of park areas. We tried to play off of this one and continue that up so that this would be basically an open lawn and there would be a small gazebo or pavilion on this end. So it would be more of a passive sort of park that people can sit, take lunch, the workers could take lunch here. I believe there's a senior center over here. Or seniors could come and utilize this park as well. There would be a pathway that would connect to the senior center. So there would be sort of the one contiguous park, but it would sort of be developed in two different ways based on the two legs of the L. The rest of the uses are designated as different types of housing, and the thought would be that you would be able to sell this to a builder, and they would be able to have three different product types for three different price points, which would make it more attractive and more diverse for a variety of different sort of demographic groups. So in this particular scheme, we're showing five townhouse lots, 25 by 100. The depth of the buildings are 40 foot deep, and then there would be a garage in the back. So we're following sort of neo-traditional design principles with the garage in the back. One of the things that we find in older towns is that, you know, they were designed for a lifestyle that is long since passed. You know, people want off-street parking, people want garages. So garage units are very popular. Now, the alternative to a garage unit would be a townhome unit with a garage underneath of it. So there's a variety of different product types that could be fit into sort of the townhouse lot model. So this one, again, just sort of playing off the history of the town and the character of a neo-traditional design, we were suggesting garages. On these five lots here, the lot size would increase to 25 by 115. So they would get, the lots would get deeper, as would the actual buildings. These would be a 60-foot deep building. They're all 25 feet wide. So this would be a bigger building, a bigger unit, a different price point. So maybe you're dealing with, you know, a single, you know, no children type of situation here. Maybe here you're dealing with someone with the family. These lots over here we're calling our village lots, and they're 40 by 130. So and there's four of them. So basically what we're doing is we're transitioning the house type to blend in with the housing that surrounds on this side. So it's a little denser in the core and it's a little less dense outside. But then again, this is another product type. This would be, you know, the highest price point, and they would be a lot bigger, you know, housing stock. So in this one, there would be, you know, there would be 14 lots. And, you know, our thought would be is that the town could act as the developer, you know, parcel out those lots, provide utilities, sell those to a builder, and they can have a significant, you know, revenue coming from the sale of those lots to a private developer. They solve the parking problem. They get housing in, increasing the tax base. So there's a lot of benefits to this scheme in our opinion. So let me present what we're gonna do, just so you know. We're gonna go through this first property and then we'll open it up for discussion and questions. So the other concept that we had was rather than go with a single family type of product, we're suggesting apartments. Again, the parking situation is an issue. When you deal with an urban type of an apartment, you're dealing with anywhere between 0.5 and 1.3 parking spots per unit. Generally, in an urban apartment situation, there's less parking requirements. If you go for a senior type of housing, senior apartments, there's even less than that. So depending on what demographic you wanted to shoot for and what product type you wanted to go for, that will impact the amount of parking that you would need. So in this one, you can see that essentially we are suggesting a very similar situation to this. Notice the green leg of this L or open space park is now taken away because we needed that for parking. We didn't need as much parking for the single family homes or townhomes. We need more for the apartments. So in this one, again, some sort of gateway plaza. Here the train caboose is on the edge. So you'd see it from the road. Remember the other one was actually back in here. Still same thing, promenade, but now the tracks, rather than being sort of laid within the walkway, are sort of on the edge of the property and have their own, you know, element to themselves. I did fail to mention on the last one we would have some sort of bike racks. There would be benches for sitting. So if indeed this is a trailhead, you know, we would have opportunities for people to park their bike there or store their bike there, et cetera. So this little dog leg would be developed into a park. And then basically what we're proposing is three apartment buildings. These particular buildings have 45 feet in depth, which actually is generous. I used some standards. I looked at some smaller apartment buildings that were developed in Baltimore in a new neo-traditional part of town that were very similar to this. They were actually only 33 feet deep, and they had 10 units apiece. So they're smaller studio-type apartments. They're not big apartments. And the new trend is that these small apartments are just going like hotcakes because everyone wants a smaller apartment. So that's the big trend in the building industry right now. So these would be apartments. Right now we're suggesting a two-story apartment building to sort of fit in with the character of the buildings across the street. But certainly you could look at three stories. So a two-story building would have about 12 units in it. So if you calculate out, that's 36 units. At 0.5 to 1.3 spots per unit, you have a requirement of anywhere between 18 to 47 spots, parking spots required based on those ratios. In this scheme, we're providing 76 spots. So if this indeed did want to go up to three stories, that would bring the units up to 36 plus 18. Help me out with math, 54. So, you know, we've still exceeded the parking requirements even at a three-story building. So, based on that, we also showed that because we've exceeded the parking capacity, there's no need to provide extra parking. So there may be opportunities to utilize some of those spots in stormwater management. So we have shown areas for stormwater management within the development. But until the site's actually engineered and all those quantities are evaluated, the size of the ponds is to be determined. In this particular scheme, we're suggesting to make a connection to Prince Street. Price Street. So again, continuing to try and, you know, keep the grid open. We don't know the logistics of doing that, but anything could be done if it wanted to be done. So again, just trying to keep the grid open, reconnect the grid. We know it was open at one point in time. And so that's the second scheme. So let me show you the next slide we have here. Let me fast forward a little bit. So these are some images just to kind of give you a feel of the character that at least we have in our mind. It's pretty much what you see driving around town. I mean, they're sort of neo-traditional building styles. These are all brand new buildings. So this would be sort of an example of your cottage type of home. It would really be your traditional sort of early 1900s, almost like a farmhouse type of product with the garage connected in the back. These are the apartments. These are brand new apartments. These were built about 4 years ago in Baltimore, and you could see the back of these units. So it's a small apartment building. They're only 33 feet deep. They're very small units. There's actually 10 units in this building. And then you can see the townhouses Again, just to kind of give you a feel for this one has a stick of four. This one has a stick of one, two, three, four, six. And then sort of what the streetscape would look like. There really wouldn't be any significant yards. You might have a two or three foot sort of green space in front of that building, but they would really be set close to the street just like they traditionally would have been in traditional town planning. So that's our recommendations for the railroad properties. At this point in time, I think we're going to open it. We have some handouts that Dana is going to pass out.
We have two new committee members that arrived. I'd like to introduce Kara Snyder-Dunham. Where is Tobina? Right. And Greg Torchio, who's also on our committee, who's a local architect. Before we get started, I might want to ask Greg to explain the eclectic nature of the architecture on Pennsylvania Avenue, how it got to be that way, because whatever goes across the street from that really has to honor the efforts that were made on Pennsylvania Avenue and keep that at sort of a cohesive look. Can you explain where that came from?
It's pretty simple. The owners came to me and said they wanted to get a similar feel that Lawyer's Row had. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, which is an eclectic mix of buildings, and that both vary in height, width, and architectural style. So that's, you know, what we strive for on that side of Pennsylvania Avenue.
And for new construction, it really works. Very cohesively down the entire length of that street. During our discussions with the folks who decided to join us during our walkabout, there was a considerable amount of discussion about commercial versus residential, as Scott kind of referred to, and very many concerns about vacant commercial in the town. Do we want to create more potential vacancies? Do we want to relocate it like mercury on a tabletop? There's only a finite amount of it, and we just keep pushing it around and losing areas of the downtown to these perimeter areas and so on. So the overarching message that we heard then, and you all may completely disagree with this, but this is what your fellow citizens arrived at before, was that the rental housing, quality rental housing, was much, much more desirable and needed in the town. The developer of Pennsylvania Avenue averred to all of us that his apartments were fully rented with a waiting list. And these are nice apartments, very nice apartments, ranging from 1 to 3 bedrooms, I think. And they're filled constantly. That is what and Queen Anne's County, we also learned, is last in the state for its percentage of rental housing to the entire housing market, which is fairly appalling. But it also goes to explain why that the folks that that were at our previous meeting felt that that residential with a really good quality housing option that kind of matched what was going on there seemed a good idea. So, yeah, Scott, you want to go ahead and we can open this up for public comment. We do have some handouts. I hope everybody gets a chance to take a look at them. I'll certainly share my pack with anybody who did. Dan, did you need a set? You got one, okay.
Any questions or comments or thoughts?
Yeah, and if you do, you'll have to speak to the microphone. So, Scott, you want to move that microphone back to the... we'll put it at the put it back on the stand.
Okay. Oh, that's right. Just
yeah. I'll put it on the stand. Yeah. Nope. Carolyn, right in the mic stand.
Yeah. I'll stay here.
Yeah. There you go. Yeah. Please introduce yourself with your name and where you live, and feel free to make that. Like I say, we've made every effort not to make these look like or even perceived to be final in any way. So we'd love to have your comments.
I'm Denise Malik, and I live on Centreville Avenue. Mm-hmm. I was just wondering about that first meeting, the walk around. I had found out about it too late, and it was also a super hot day, I don't know if I would have gone anyway.
Right.
But I was wondering who did or how many went, what kind of input did you get at that day? Because I think it would have been a small sample size.
Yeah. What we did, we actually ended up with folks who were primarily interested in the wharf, showed up at the wharf. people that were interested in the mill stream and the connections of the railroad to the mill stream showed up at the mill stream, and folks that were interested in the commercial, the downtown, more urban, closer to town part about the, and the railroaders showed up at the railroad meeting. So I'd say, did we have a total, did you have a total list of attendees?
I would say we heard from about 30 to 40 people.
30 to 40 people, yeah. But they weren't all in one spot.
And yeah. I will say, we at 4:30, we were on the courthouse grounds.
You got to go to the mic.
At 4:30, sorry, George. At 4:30, we were on the courthouse grounds outdoors, and those huge trees on the courthouse was like in air conditioning. It was wonderful. So just know that you have a wonderful town that breathes green.
Going to the issue of sampling, if you wanted to kind of look at it from a percentage basis. When you ask for volunteers, that's one thing. When you ask the public to come out and make comment, and this was well advertised, by the way, well in advance through all of the town's media. We made sure that it got out in releases, both in the newspaper and in the town's website. But nevertheless, you know, it was a brutally hot day, and so that was probably the most limiting factor.
I'd like to comment on a couple schemes, if I could. Mm-hmm. One of the requirements for the Penn Station development was that parking was going to be provided on this lot that we're talking about. And there's this agreement that was never executed, you know. But nonetheless, Planning Commission gave approval to each one of these buildings up to building F based on parking being available across the street. So where the individual townhomes, individual house scheme provides no additional parking, I could see that being really problematic for the neighborhood. The apartments, on the other hand, you provide, I think you said 72 spaces, which is precisely what our calculation was, you know, what's required for the build out on the other side of the street. And right now, it works pretty well with the apartments and the commercial where they share the same parking. So, you know, that's an issue that the town needs to address and work with the property owners across the street and come up with some kind of agreement before you sell it all as residential lots and end up in a lawsuit. You know, I mean, it has to be addressed.
May I, Scott, could you just tell us, Your parking calculations for both sites, did you include the on-street parking along Pennsylvania Avenue, or is that additional?
The number that you see on this particular scheme shows 76 units on off-site, and there's parallel parking across the street in the amount of 8 + 5 + 6, 19. There's 19 parallel parking, so there's on street. There will be on street parking on both sides, and so I think to address your question, we didn't ignore the parking requirements, but we did, and I think we did that because we think there's a much higher and better use to this site, and that we are encouraging the town to sort of come together and try and resolve that, because parking is not the highest and best use of that site. And after walking through town and hearing people talk about parking and see it anecdotally that it really wasn't an issue, we're just challenging the town to have those discussions to see what's the highest and best use of their investment of that property.
And so, maybe a parking study to help with that decision. Has the town done a parking?
The parking study has
been done?
Just
okay.
A couple years ago.
Yeah.
Okay. 4 years ago.
Yes, come on up.
Yes, hi. I'm Rebecca Marcourt. I'm vice president of the Historical Society.
Hi.
I visit some of the offices and the store on Pennsylvania Avenue often. Mm-hmm. During the weekday, between 9 and 5, the parking lot over there is full. Mm-hmm. And sometimes I've got to park on another street and walk over there. Mm-hmm. So you definitely don't have enough parking.
Right.
And the first building's a medical center. Mm-hmm. It's still a medical center, isn't it,
yes.
Greg?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And it is vacant.
It's vacant.
Yeah. Oh, it's vacant right now?
Yeah. No, they're down the street.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. So I've giving you my opinion.
Thank you. Well, yeah, and you're quite right. And part of the reason is that the parking there is a little bit of a boondoggle as it is, because it's straight in parking on a two-way street, which is a nightmare to begin with. So, and it's not efficient use of the parking space. So the town has other options in there when this is developed, to clean up the way that parking lot is currently laid out, which is you know, kind of dangerous to begin with, as you well know. So yeah, right now they're yeah. So that much we would certainly hope to be doing. And if it means in the course of that we compromise the amount of development, and like we say, nothing is cast in stone at all, then so be it. But a good balance has to be found in that area.
Yeah, Mike, and that's a good. I'd just like to add to that, and keep in mind that these are, you know, two different conceptual approaches. They're the first flush. And so, for instance, in this particular scenario, if the town comes back to us and says, well, look, we have to deal with parking a little better than what you're proposing. We can't go full development. You know, we need to address more parking. Well, then we start looking about, well, how do we address more parking? Well, the way you do it in this scheme is you sacrifice one of these buildings. Mm-hmm. And so you have less development density on this site. You know, the other thing I'd like to add, that what we're trying to accomplish here is to sort of complete the sense of a street.
Right.
So, you know, we're trying to have, you know, buildings front buildings instead of a series of vacant spaces opening other buildings. So in this instance, you know, we kept the buildings fairly close here. That's why the parking is on this side. The parking is on this side. So we compress the buildings and we have that facade that's as intact as we can get it. So let's just say you come back and say, well, we need more parking, then and you want to see apartments, then my recommendation would be to eliminate this building, have parking here. But there's also a vacant lot right here. So there's an opportunity to have parking in there. I know a previous scheme shows a building to be fit in there, and ideally you want to plug all the holes with buildings, but there's a potential for parking there as well. On the townhouse schemes, if the town decided that they wanted to go with townhomes, then, you know, one of these sticks of buildings could come out, and there could be a parking lot, and a parking lot. So there's options. It's going to be a balance of needs. You're never going to satisfy everybody's parking. You're not going to satisfy the parking requirements. And so where is that balance? Where is that blend? You know, are you willing to walk a block? You know, that's, and I'm, you don't have to answer that, but I mean, that's one block. Okay, so she's willing to walk a block, sold, you know? So I mean, those are the kinds of discussions. Or if it's hot.
Right, there you go.
So, but those are the discussions that the town will have to engage in, and there's going to be compromises all along the way.
Mm-hmm. If I could add to that, I think part of the issue of parking is the walking. If we can make the walking as pleasant as possible, maybe a few more street trees designed into this. We have concepts called green streets. We have concepts called complete streets. I like the stub of Price Street in the site, because it struck me that you could use that as a demonstration to show what a complete street means. You know, how beautiful you can design the street, how green you can make the street. You can make it a sort of gathering space as well as, you know, through space for walking, so that you get a better sense. And maybe all of Pennsylvania Avenue could be treated that way, so that all of a sudden it's not a chore to walk from your car to the other end of that long block, but you want to. So then you begin, of course, pushing parking out into the neighborhood, and then you've got another problem. But there's, I think, ways of creating in this space, a way of creating a dialogue for the town to say, you know, as we develop, as we get further out toward the high school and we see more development happening, we really like what's happening on Pennsylvania Avenue. You're already getting that kind of message. So how can we make that even more of a model for what you are investing in as a community? And the other question I've got for all of you is the idea of senior housing. I don't think you have, other than the facility that's up across from just before you get out to the church, to the Methodist Church on the other side of the street there, I'm not sure what senior housing you actually have in town.
Yeah. Well, parking. Tillman Terrace is actually a senior project.
And parking requirements. Parking and requirements for senior housing are even less.
Well, when that building was originally done, if anybody goes out to Tillman Terrace, you'll see that virtually all the parking is not used. It's amazing how much parking is just sitting there completely unused.
Yeah.
And that's because that nature of that housing, those folks just are not, they're not two-car families, and they're not even one-car family. So, and they use the county, in some cases, county ride, you know, transportation, and housing authority transportation. So there is a model that could, you know, that we could look at that could actually even fit in that, if that were a way to go.
That reminds me to mention something about Scott's scope, and that is that we stayed on the site. You know, ideally, there's some other issues going on for the town.
Sure.
Looking at Steve, because he knows what's coming for the courthouse.
Right.
Lots of things are going to change the sort of dynamic for that entire end of town. And maybe before you try to program this site completely, you perhaps need to do a little bit more urban design planning from the courthouse site all the way over and around. That whole block, you know, you sort of step back and you realize that entire block could be planned for sort of long-term redevelopment. Or right to the question of the parking with Tillman Terrace, is there a way to sort of, when you finally get to this actual design for this, can you get an agreement with the Tillman Terrace folks and bring that parking into the sort of way that you're dealing with it, and really rationalize some of that? Is there a, should that be an alley that connects to Little Kidwell? You know, there's a lot of different details that we can't get into here. What we're trying to do is show you trade-offs. But it does begin to open, I think, a conversation about how this, the dynamic of what could happen here changes a lot of other things all around. It's a great example of what planning should do. It should create this dialogue and help you think through some of these things.
Also, I think it's important to mention, he's mentioned the possible trailhead there. I think, Patrick, you know, that's one of your, you know, babies. But we have been working with the county. The county started back in the beginning of 2000s. To look at doing a rail to trail, which would have converted that railroad to a hiker biker path all the way out to the beyond the Haymaker property, all the way out to what would be the future Centreville Business Park, which means it goes past the high school. Our Parks Board, we have been very interested in pursuing that, partly because of the goal of having school children getting to their schools by bike and by walking, instead of you know, being picked up every 3 feet along the street by a school bus and delivered there for some liability reason. But we have a bunch of kind of overweight school kids who could probably use that trail pretty effectively. And doing that, our goal from the Parks Board would have used that as the trailhead, or that as the anchor area right on the railroad property. And then at some point be able to museum that the history of the trail, I mean, history of the rail at that site to create a further point of focus. So that is an artery leading into this property that that we hope will prevail.
Well, now that's there is another question, and again it's sort of, you know, for want of a shoe, you know, the battle is what is a trailhead exactly? You know, right now it's designed as park use and a beautiful place to start, mm-hmm. but where do you park your car when you bring your bike to start there?
Well, there, yeah. We were thinking, because there was a park proffer on Little Hut Drive, we have many acres up there that we could actually create the vehicle point of that, and then you bike either way, left and right from that. So up by the detention center on that one side, mm-hmm. and down by the Centreville apartments down there, we have 2 acres of ground there, mm-hmm. That can create those where you actually park away from the town and either walk or bike into town. And for those that are inclined to do that, that's a great way to use that property.
Scott, I have just one other quick comment about the apartment scheme. I think that would require some alteration to the zoning, and it would
commercial
be good.
Right?
It would be good to make it possible that if it were all apartments, that the ground floor in the future could be converted to commercial. Mm-hmm. And that could be done very easily for offices. You know, you see many residential properties around town that are used as offices. And, you know, because that may come back, and as the demand picks up, it'd be great to have the street front again be all commercial.
It would. Mm-hmm. A follow-up on that is that the state Department of Planning and many other groups have been promoting the live-work concept, and it's never really taken off, because nobody's been able to effectively sell, you know, live above your office construct, and that is a piece of modernism that may come back and be very relevant there.
Well, there was a program for, this might be for old buildings only, this is ancient history possibly too, but that is artists live work housing in arts and entertainment districts.
Right.
I'm not sure of that program. One of the things that we have to do is sort of record a lot of these comments. They don't necessarily get translated into what you'll see on these documents, but sort of what are some of the possibilities, and those go into the heritage plan. I think, though, that one of the things that we need to do, and we're coming up on the end of a discussion of Railroad Avenue here, of the railroad property on Pennsylvania Avenue, is, you know, are there things on here that you really, really like, and, you know, or should we tweak these two plans and leave them as is, or do we come to one?
Tweak one, right.
Yeah, I mean,
we tweak one.
Which do we tweak? Which do we tweak? And what do we take in from the other one? If we're tweaking one, how do we combine, in other words? The deliverable is one. So what are your choices here. What do you like? What should we do? And now I'm looking at the committee, because you all are going to have to help us.
Okay, bear in mind, we do have the signage. The big component of this is creating, interpretive signage to bring the history of this property to the public. So some space on this for that dedication is really essential to preserve the historical nature of the property.
And right now the logical place for it, of course, is the L-shaped park, the wing there at the end. That's got delineated.
So does the committee have any thoughts? Other thoughts?
I like option one.
Option one?
Option one being this one.
The apartments, no.
Oh, the other one, the apartments.
That's option two. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Rebecca, you had a, yeah.
We're used to living here with a actual train going across that street.
Mm-hmm.
Wouldn't it be wonderful to have a two-part train that would take them to a place where there would be a bus to take them to Bloomfield to see the station or to the wharf or... That would be cool.
Yeah, that you're talking about being able to link them with a piece of that.
Yeah,
you mean like a tram?
Yeah, the train and the rail tracks wouldn't have to go all the way to Bloomfield.
Right.
It could go to a piece of property where there's a bus waiting for the people and take them back.
Kind of interesting.
Okay,
yeah. That might be something we could consider on the rail to trails. Actually,
yeah,
we
they have something the like there, that kinda. In New Jersey, Northern New Jersey.
Huh.
My stepson and his.
Idea. Yeah.
Wife and my grandchild.
You remember where that
there.
Is?
Yeah, I have to look up the name.
Yeah, send us what
yeah,
you can find.
Please
do.
But it's really cool.
Concept,
it's four cars, well, a locomotive and three cars, and there's a park, and you get on, and you go a ways, and then there's a big parking lot.
Mm-hmm.
People are parked there too, because they're looking at other things, and there's a bus that'll take you here and there. Bring you back, and you get back on the train and go back to
yeah, we'd
camp.
Like to think we'd get successful enough to be able to put people in
and,
that bus. You know?
Yeah, and it, you know, it costs like $20 a family.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And it's a real old-fashioned train. Mm-hmm. You know, the windows, there's no glass in the window. You know, it's open air.
Yeah, sure.
It's really cool.
Okay, thank you.
Actually, what I thought you might tell us was that we should put a you know, we've got the caboose on one side. We could put a car on the other side of the road, sort of give that sense of that crossing that used to be there. It'd be kind of fun.
Mm-hmm.
I guess we're going to lose the rail crossing.
We have a rail guy talking to you.
Right. Well, the construction that's on the site right now is to rework Water Railroad Avenue there.
Mm-hmm.
No. Mm-hmm. You're shaking your head.
No, it is.
Is this a bioretention?
Bioretention.
Oh, they're working the bioretention now. Later, it'll become a construction site for the resurfacing of the main street there, not Pennsylvania Avenue, but the other.
Yeah, for Bramble's equipment. He's talking about contemporary construction storage and stuff.
Yeah.
Now, the bioretention is going to stay there, is it?
Oh, yes.
Royden, did you have a comment?
Yeah. I'll start with a question. Maybe Michael can answer it, or perhaps Elizabeth. And that's a process question. From a committee member's point of view, I want to understand the process that we will, you know, how will we go forward in terms of advising next steps and what ultimately comes out of the process?
Right. This is sort of an unusual grant because there's actually planning involved in it, or some very preliminary level of planning involved in the overall development of the Heritage Trail. So the purpose of our stuff is to look at the heritage and the history, to document that and to memorialize that in interpretive signing where people would actually see it. These concept plans arose in the course of developing this grant, which is a little bit unusual because normally we don't. Normally there is not this level that Scott's gone to now to try to establish. So we have no authority or purview over anything that goes forward beyond this point other than to try to find consensus, put it up there to the part that we know that we have to do is to maintain the interpretive heritage trail as best we can between these points of interest. What actually goes on those is certainly up to future generations and others.
Let me ask the question a little more directly then.
Yeah.
Is tonight the committee's opportunity to influence the next step?
For these two
yeah,
projects,
yeah,
yes.
Absolutely.
But you have more opportunity. Scott's job should be at the end of the evening to go home and take one of these, tweak it, and be done. And we can keep the earlier ones as project record, and they can be part of what you'll keep.
Okay.
You know, it's not like you lose that.
But so you have a thought you wanted to advance.
Yeah.
Okay.
On. Yeah.
First comment is recognizing they were in a concept stage anyway. Clearly, these drawings don't reflect what's currently happening on the site with the buyer retention sale. So if we're doing calculations about footprint mm-hmm. and site planning, down to the level of doing parking analysis, I think you got to consider the square footage that's not going to be available by virtue of the current stormwater management project.
However,
this concept leaves the existing bios retention area intact. But I would say that with all due respect to how the bio retention area came to be, it's a little sort of the cart before the horse. Mm-hmm. You kind of seized the grant opportunity before thinking about how you're going to develop that site, and you very well may have precluded opportunities in the future. So I respect that comment. I think that's going to have to be an issue that's going to be addressed when you're actually ready to turn this into money.
Mm-hmm.
And that cart before the horse may be an appropriate segue for my second or third comment, I guess. And that is, not having been a part of the earlier process, but to start into this with what I see as a predetermined decision about a fairly intensive land use mm-hmm. leaves little opportunity to explore other options.
Mm-hmm. So for the railroad, you mean?
For the use of the property in general.
Okay.
So to the extent that open space is a fairly rare commodity and that we've talked about parking limitations, we're talking about land uses that are just going to exacerbate that problem. So alternatively, are there other land uses or other uses of that property that A, would provide the open space, recreational opportunity, greater space for this railhead concept, and a greater opportunity, I believe, to actually, if this is about heritage, to preserve the heritage of that site and recognize that and how that site gets developed as that property.
Could be a community park.
Yeah. Exactly.
Yes.
It could be a community park with adequate parking to handle all of the businesses. There's no question that that's an option. The initial guidance in the grant, however, and that's kind of how we got started down this trail,
mm-hmm.
Was that that the property was purchased and it was a costly addition to the town, that we ought to be doing something. Is there a way to make it a revenue generator rather than continue it as a passive park? But community park and place, that's perfectly viable.
I believe that's in keeping with at least having been involved with when that property was acquired
mm-hmm.
in town. I think that would be more in keeping with the use of a municipal property. And also, having spent a few hours on the site, mm-hmm. there's a fair amount of pedestrian traffic that occurs from both the senior center and the residential areas around the community.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that could be accommodated in the design of an open space as well. So.
Yeah. Well, one of the things is, and we did hear this, and we need to get to Mr. Beecham here, but we did hear that comment during, and I heard one comment after from someone who grew up in Centreville who said, gee, there's not a whole lot of open space in that whole area, and what a shame to lose some of that open space. And that sort of walkers' use of the area, cut-throughs and children playing, whatever. So, but the thing is that Scott could give us the more intensive vision for you to play off that idea. And when we write up the heritage plan, we can put all these recommendations and this conversation in place for additional conversation. This group does not need to make a decision, but if you have a strong recommendation to go in that direction versus this, you've had an opportunity at least to see what it draws out at.
Okay.
Yeah, and I think just to add to that real quick, I know we got to get moving, and I think to your point is that we were trying to steer you away from retail with these concepts, and I think that we've done that. And so I think that if the next kind of reiteration and that the community overwhelmingly feels that this space needs to be green space, then, you know, the next pass at this concept needs, then if the town says this is going to be green space, then that's the dedicated use. The challenge for us is we didn't walk out of there with any definitive desire from the community as to what this wanted to be. We heard bits and pieces. We heard some green space. We tried to acknowledge it in this concept with a little more green space. So I think that's I agree with Mike. It's a completely viable option as a scenario. Absolutely.
Yeah. And it certainly works with the heritage aspect that we were going to do with the signage and the interpretive history of the property.
And the last comment, just from a planning point of view, to the extent that there's interest in more, I'll say commercial or more intensive land use, there's still property available on the existing side of Railroad Avenue that's undeveloped. So I'd suggest that's an opportunity from a planning point of view to chart that as a build out, and then with this other vision for this other property being more open.
And parking to accommodate when it goes.
Yes.
Sure.
And if I can
good point.
Mayor Murray, can we get Mr. Beecham first?
If you'd like to, go ahead, please.
Go ahead.
I like both your designs, and the concept of open space is great, too. For any of those three ideas, I wonder if we couldn't somehow mirror the turntable that was into that site as a design detail that's probably beyond the level that we're approaching here. But since we're after railroad heritage here, if there's some way to have either the buildings or the design of the open space somehow reflect or respond to that turntable, I think that'd be a fabulous piece of heritage emulate.
And that would be just for those of you who don't know where the turntable was, it would be where the cottage homes are. It's right about in there. So, you know, that again, if you take one third of this and leave it open space, and maybe you keep one end at the other end as the sort of trail heritage piece of it, and the other end is the open space, and then you've got an opportunity to deal with that.
Or fan the building out in the semicircle somehow just to respond to the turntable notion.
Again, I absolutely. I mean, I think, you know, there's a myriad of different scenarios that can be moved on here, and I think, you know, the challenge is really up to you to decide what you want to do. I mean, if our direction was that this was to be a park and we were to take great advantage of the heritage of the railroad other than what we did, there's a myriad of possibilities. I mean, it could be fantastic. There's a myriad of possibilities here.
Good.
You know, so you know, we kind of backed away from the retail, heard kind of the community, sensed that there was a need for residential. We definitely heard the heritage. Again, obviously, we picked up on the train and the parklet at the trailhead. But again, if the town decided that this is green space and it's going to be a park, I mean, then there's a whole different thought process that goes into designing this site. So, you know, again, it's up to the town to decide kind of how they want to use the site.
Mary Margaret?
Well, I just wanted to comment that from the very beginning, Mike very well knows that one of my great dreams and plans is to actually bring back the turntable. It would be a tremendous asset. The point about all of this is that we do need more tourism in Centreville, and you've got to have things for people to come and visit. And I love the idea. Both Tim and I have talked about the caboose, and I need to get stuff that's going to go in it out of my house, but
we can help you with that.
Yeah,
we can help with that.
I know you can.
The railroaders can help you.
I'm giving
that.
You all the stuff I'm going to
Oh, come on.
Oh,
No, not really. But there's a lot more that can be done to build on that concept and to honor so much of what went down on that site. And I can tell you that from what I've seen of the history over the years in reports I've been looking at, you have no idea.
Mm-hmm. Cool.
That's right.
All right.
I have some comments.
Yeah. Qualms or comments?
Both. I went up Kidwell about 10 days ago, a week ago, and there was the old railroad yard, the switch yard. And I went up there yesterday, and there's a crater. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's just not a small crater, but unless I've totally lost the perspective here on the size, that crater is going to encompass a good bit of that housing down there at that lower end. Mm-hmm. And I can't imagine, frankly, I'm not familiar, but I certainly will make it my business to find out what that crater represents.
Well, Scott did have the CAD drawing for where that's going. It's designed
in. That's the bioretention
as
well. Like being constructed in front of the Board of Ed building.
Yeah, unless they're not following the drawings.
The other question that I have is...
No kidding.
Somewhere along the line, I missed something.
Yeah.
Because I don't know where we got to this point from where we started out. We started out in talking about the heritage of Centreville and making and, you know, attracting people to the town of Centreville, to the wharf area, a connecting walking trail up to the park, a trail up to the Pennsylvania Railroad property, and then back again through town, through the courthouse somewhere in that area, and then down again. And it seemed to me that the whole thing is an emphasis on interest, an appreciation of the past of this town and the values that I came here years ago because I had a choice of any of a number of communities to move into. And I moved into Centreville because, frankly, it was one of the few towns around here, aside from the Eastons, ruling out Chestertown. It seemed to me that Centreville was real. It had real people. Their feet were on the ground. They had some dirt and dust under their fingernails, and some of the people here could buy and sell me dozens of times over, and yet you could still see them walking around in their work clothes. But it was a comfortable and real town. And we had there was a message here that we started with of looking at the wharf. You know, the idea of the signage, I've been thinking about that, and frankly, to begin with, I wasn't really sold on it, but I've become really sold on it. I'm thinking of standing down at the wharf with signage, because Mary Margaret knows, and a lot of other people know, that when you look down that, down the Corsica River, okay, there are some events there that took place. There was a whole way of life that took place, that if that were illustrated on that signage, if there were pictures of the past there, so that when you're standing at a spot and you look down that river at what it is now, if you could see in front of you what it was, that has impact to me. But I don't see how in the world we got from this mission, and I just must be a little bit dense on this whole thing, to planning a whole community there in Pennsylvania Avenue and in that property. Mm-hmm. I thought it was to have been a interest thing, a recreation thing. I don't see how this is going to bring any people in. I'm not going to get in my car and drive here to look at apartments. And I'm just baffled by the whole thing.
Yeah, it's a very peculiar process. Well, I have to tell you that the original grant, when we had the depot building and we had structures and we had stuff there, was somewhat different than it became over the last couple of years. And then when the town asked me to look at this, there was already written into the grant these conceptual looks. What could these possibly be? If the ultimate plan of this is a recreation of the old alignment, a few mules, a couple of switches, a lot of green space, a bioretention area, which shouldn't have been put where it is, but that's the only put there because that end of Pennsylvania Avenue always floods,
then you would have had that is perfectly within line of what the grant has asked us to do. Where we have properties that were purchased by the town for real money, you know, to immediately, just exactly as Scott says, to immediately go to park garners just as much criticism in this town. We put a little parklet down at the bottom of the hill. You may have noticed the Pop Taylor Park, Leon Taylor, to honor a citizen of Centreville. And my God, you would have thought that we were squandering hundreds of thousands of dollars uselessly, you know, on a piece of property the size of a postage stamp. Multiply that and envision what might happen up there. So I think the process that we're in right now is working ourselves away from commercial, exactly as Scott has said. Sounds like we're working our way potentially away from residential, okay? But we have to do that in a process that when we arrive at the park, that it's a process that arrives at the park. It isn't that we just pick the park. You follow me? I think it's perfectly viable.
I agree with you because I happen to think even if you don't like, you know, if you want to sit and nitpick about the Pop Taylor Park, mm-hmm. and all that, I think there is something that has to do with ambiance.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
And I think that ambiance, you know, a lot of my friends, my wife, for example, would love to see the whole center of the town, the old center of town, revitalized. As long as I've lived here, for 40 years, I've heard people telling me how charming it is. Mm-hmm. I mean, where else could you go for lunch except the New York restaurant, right, and have mush rat? You know, you can't find too many people that'll do that.
Uh-huh.
But that was ambiance, and that's literally why I moved here.
And that's
because
Tony,
it was reality.
Right.
And to me, this is too much. Mm-hmm. But there seems to me to be, I don't know, some kind of a happy medium here on this whole thing. And I guess I'm a little lost on this, because to me it seems very simple. You can either go commercial, which I don't think is practical in that location, or you can go residential, or you can really try to preserve it as open space and try to bring back some of the recognition of that ambiance of the past.
That's the consensus we're looking for.
And that's the process that we're trying to get you through.
Yeah.
Is for the town to see the options, to see the scenarios, and to make a decision as to which way they want to go. So in the interest of time, I know we do need to get moving here. So I think that's a good place to segue, because that's the perfect scenario.
Mm-hmm.
This is a process, and the town needs to see what the opportunities and options are for various development or green space scenarios and come to a consensus in terms of what they want to do with their open space that they own.
Our parks board can work forever getting grants to work on this and build a full-fledged park out of it. Yeah, but we can't just do that in the public environment and be crucified. But arriving at it through consensus is the answer. Mm-hmm. And I think, Lou, you hit it exactly. And you've actually picked up with what we found working our way away from some of these other concepts. We stopped at the residential because reluctant to make the big step to a non-revenue generating piece of property. But that doesn't necessarily have to be true either. For example, in the wharf, you may have we'll talk about the wharf later. But revenue generators that don't take away from the opportunities, you know, the opportunities of it being open space. Thanks.
Okay. All right. So now we're going to go to the wharf site. And we're going to continue to, you know, listen all night. We're here for a while. I'd kind of like to be done at 9, but we're already over time a little bit on the railroad. We thought we could do the railroad in 45 minutes.
I'll present this in 2 minutes.
Let's do it. All right. And we have stacks of these in a minute for you, but let's just pay attention to Scott and the screen and his presentation.
Okay. So, again, you know, our job was to kind of decipher what we heard and what we didn't hear. We heard a lot of ideas, but we heard no definitive desires. So again, this is a process where we're fleshing out kind of what we heard and what we think as a professional the site has the potential to yield. But also, you know, we heard Mike talk about revenue generation. There was some concepts presented for the site that, boy, it would be nice if we can generate some money from this site. We heard an earlier concept that talked about a restaurant. You know, people were courting a restaurant for various years. You know, there are certain economic practicalities that certain, uses just won't work. They sound romantic and they sound nice, but the economic viability of certain uses in certain locations is just not going to work. I mean, this isn't St. Michael's. You know, this is Corsica River, which in its beauty is fundamentally a cul-de-sac. You know, so, you know, people aren't just driving by it. You know, they're not driving by it. So there's a number of economic reasons that we can go into. But so what we tried to do was we tried to hear as much as we could and grab as many ideas that we thought that were viable for use on this site. So we
Scott,
felt,
yes. I'm sorry to interrupt you, but I just want to point out that there are two sites, and Scott's got presentation to make for both sides of Watson Road. But
correct.
For thank interest you. Of scale and differences of the site, so just know that he's getting to the other side, those of you who know that the town owns both properties. Both
which
properties
is this property right here.
Yeah, we'll get there.
Right.
All right.
So we heard a couple things. So, you know, during this 8 hours, we were desperately trying to put a program together. A program is what you're going to do on that site. So there were some things that we heard. We heard playground. There's one out there now. We heard that wants to stay. We heard a band shell or some kind of large pavilion. We taught, there was an example, was it the Leonardtown example?
Chestertown,
excuse me, that was used.
And Leonardtown.
There was a Leonardtown Riverwalk that was mentioned, which I'll get to in a minute, which is a completely different scenario here. There was parking. There was desire for picnicking. There was maybe opportunity for a vendor, restrooms. And then one thing that we observed in town, as a small town, is somebody has to take care of this. And so whatever you do on it, you have to be able to maintain it. And so how are you going to maintain it? And we do a lot of parks in a lot of different parts of the country. And believe me when I tell you, parks are hard to take care of. Trees and lawn, simple and clean. That's the easiest way to develop a park, particularly in a small town when resources are incredibly scarce. So that's kind of what we had to work with. We had some constraints. There was an existing boardwalk that was put in place and a 25-foot buffer and setback that was sort of hands off. Do not touch, do not cross that line. It was barbed wire. So we worked back from that. There was also some armoring that was done over to this edge, some wetlands that were created, an existing walkway that will remain in place in this scheme. Now that doesn't mean in the future schemes you can't readdress that. It's just a bigger process and more money. So at this point in time, we kind of said, stay away from that. So what we tried to do was incorporate all of those elements. So we tried to accommodate a number of different things. And I guess the first thing that we noticed that was spectacular about the site was the view up the pipe, if you will. You know, when you stand here and you look right up the Corsica River, that's just the most spectacular view. And so we felt we wanted to somehow take advantage of that. So you can see the general orientation of this is in this direction. So we thought that the amphitheater or the band shell or the concert pavilion was a really great idea. The way that these parks are successful is the way that the community activates them. You can't build it and expect it to come. You have to build it and program it, and then they'll come. And so the idea of a concert pavilion we thought was a fantastic idea. So we created this whole central area out that would be basically a lawn. There's about, 6 or 7 foot of grade change between this part of the site and this part of the site, which would allow this to be perfectly sloped downwards so that when you're sitting in an amphitheater, you know, you want to be able to look over the head in front of you, so that's best to have a sloped lawn. So there would be some kind of pavilion that would be down at this end that would basically, as you're looking out towards the pavilion, the backdrop is going to be the court looking down the throat of the Corsica River. So that's how that sort of axis, if you will, got established, you know, plus or minus. We also felt that the playground, in light of that use, would be best positioned near the band shell so that as there were concerts being had, the kids could be down here on the playground, the parents could still keep an eye on them. Everything's kind of right there in their field of view. That sort of linked keeping it close to the water, keeping it close to the parking, The parking kind of, in this particular scheme, it seemed to make sense just to extend the existing parking lot and work off of the existing drive aisles to get into the parking area. So if somebody wanted to come and just drive their kids down to the playground, they could pull in this parking lot and have direct access to the playground. The playground would be designed to have two different age groups to it. Right now you have one big playground. This would have a separated, segregated play sets for young children and for older children. So these would be two separate use areas. The other thing that we did was we tried to create sort of a separate area that would have individual pavilions. So there was a talk of, well, maybe we can rent these pavilions. I know that a lot of parks that we've designed or parks that I've actually participated in, you know, we go to the parks department, we get a permit for a pavilion, we get the pavilion for $25 for 6 hours, and we have our family reunion there. And so these pavilions, of course, would be located on the water, and those could be rented. Or if the city or the town chooses not to rent them, they could be free. Again, it's up to how you want to manage your own park. In this upper area here, we felt that this was sort of the most intense or urban part of the site because it was closest to the road. So any type of commercial use or activity, whatever that would be, in this scheme, we felt would want to happen here. So as you come down Watson Road, the first thing you would see is this little pavilion. This particular pavilion we have at about 1,600 square foot. It's actually not really a pavilion. I guess it's a small structure. Mm-hmm. We don't know what's going to happen in there. I mean, you can have hot dog stands. You can have lemonade vendors. You can have a community room that you can rent out in there. You know, there could be restrooms in there. We know that there was talk of converting restrooms over to here, but that may or may not be a temporary scenario. So who knows what this building could be programmed as? It could be a bait store, you know, I mean, who knows? You know, but it's some kind of smaller commercial seasonal enterprise that you're not going to expect someone to come there and actually try and stay in business, because I think in this site, it's going to be very difficult to get someone to actually come down there, have a building, and stay in business. So it would be a seasonal type of thing. So that, of course, is right when this would be a smaller, you know, paved area. It would be sort of like a small plaza. You know, we talked about interpretation things. You know, there could be a lot of interpretation that happens in this plaza that tells the story of the site. And then there, of course, could be additional interpretive markers along the trail. So that's scheme one. Oh, also we have two other pavilions here. So a total of four pavilions all along this edge. A large concert pavilion, the amphitheater, and you know the more intensely developed plaza space. So that's scheme one. Scheme two, same programmatic elements done differently. So in this particular concept, we kind of flipped it. There's an existing curb cut that's off of Watson Road now. So in this particular scheme, we're basically keeping that curb cut and we're having the parking up against the road. We're completely segregating this parking with this parking. This is your, you know, boat ramp, sort of water activity parking. This is your park parking. They're two completely separate. They're not related. But in this one, we felt that there were some crossover activities between what happens here with fishing, with boating, that can sort of tie into maybe this commercial use or smaller use of this building, so that the plaza would actually be down at the lower end, so that there would be some crossover use between the activities that happen over here and the activities that happen in the park, which could potentially make this commercial enterprise more viable, because you have more traffic, more activity, it's more convenient, it's not sort of as isolated, if you will, up here. So that smaller sort of plaza area, welcome area, entry into the park would happen in this lower corner. Same concept, we'd have a sort of a smaller promenade that would walk out into the amphitheater. And in this particular area instance, we sort of shifted the pavilion over a little. You know, you could debate whether the pipe of that Corsica River, because it does some weird turns, is here or here or here. It's kind of, you know, it could really fit anywhere in this zone and you still get that full effect. But this really keeps it completely open. There's nothing happening down here. So the same thing, amphitheater, play area. The play area roughly is about here now. So the play area moves closer to the road, which would potentially make it a little more convenient. So if moms or dads wanted to drive in real quick, park here, get to the playground and leave, you know, they wouldn't have to come all the way down into here. So it could be perceived as being more convenient. Same concept, you know, older children, smaller children, right there to the parking lot for those lazy moms that don't want to have to walk very far. It's right there, and I know they're out there. And then a same concept here, too, with the little sort of rentable areas. These would be designed more as sort of complete picnic spaces, if you will, so that there would be a large paved area that would have picnic tables, could have barbecue pits, could have the, you know, sort of their own little, you got your own little sort of niche to have your little family event in there. And of course, it would be a circuitous pathway. So if someone wanted to come and walk and just kind of walk around the site, you know, you could basically make a loop. You know, I know moms like to do the stroller thing. I know because I have a wife who's a mom who does the stroller thing. You know, so there's a little loop around there. And so this is concept option number two. So I have just a couple images just to kind of give you a, let me get to the images, I'm sorry. So just a couple images of what some of these space, some of these elements might look like, you know, picking up on the architecture that has a vernacular of town and kind of just, I don't know what that would call, there's an architect back there that's craftsman or I'm not sure what that style would be, but this is actually a little, a lemonade stand that's down in Fells Point at the end of Broadway Market. Our office is about five blocks from here. And this guy sells, there's a lemonade guy in there and there's a pretzel guy in there. Mm. And they're seasonal. And so in the winter, it shuts down. In the summer, they pretty much operate. It's perfect. This is something a little bigger. There's some restrooms in there and there's a little vendor that's in there. Just, you know, this the small pavilions, picnic pavilions could look like anything. And just this little sort of image of the lawn with the spiral walkway running through it. So just to give you some visuals of what that could be. So the other side of the road, it's a challenging little site to really do something with. You're not getting trailers in there. So you're not going to park trailers that are, you know, bringing their boat down and parking over there. I mean, there's no way for these guys to turn around. So, you know, what do you do? Well, we heard parking, you know, not enough parking, not enough parking, not enough parking. So, if you so choose, this site can accommodate a parking lot. And we felt that, you know, and it literally just fits because the slope starts to tuck up along here and it takes more space to get that spot. We didn't know the exact wetland line, but we delineated it roughly about where the Phragmites is, which is probably a good indicator of where that line is going to be. So you literally can just squeeze in a bay of parking. We got in about 45 spots, and we felt that this could basically be somewhat of an extension of the wharf site over here. This sort of lower corner, you can have a small pavilion, so you could still have this be a nice secluded, you know, but open picnic area, lounging area, you know, whatever you want to use it for. And we thought that it would be really neat to have a boardwalk. Someday we'd love to see the Phragmites dealt with, you know, eradicate it and turn this into a real, you know, working marsh, functional marsh. That'll be a never-ending battle, but something that can be won. So a boardwalk out to some sort of overlook pavilion, fishing pier, you know, out on the river. So it's sort of an extension of what's going on over here. The other option would be, you know, if people can relax a little bit about parking. And look, parking is an issue everywhere we go. I mean, it's the same thing. Just keep it simple, open space. You know, don't get too sophisticated. Keep it simple. Just simply have a walkway that comes through. There was talk of wanting to actually make a sidewalk along here. We fully support, you know, having that connectivity to town. You do run into some challenges up here on some of these properties. There's some grade challenges. There's probably some property issues you're going to run into. It can be done, but I think there's a hole in the donut right up here with some properties that might prevent this walkway from getting installed, but you know, shoot for the moon. So there would have to be ADA access down this slope. So there would have to be some kind of switchback to get people down to the bottom there. We felt that this pavilion could be sort of sitting up. Of those of you that are familiar with the site, you know, this slopes down. This is probably 12, 13 feet lower than the road up here, that this pavilion would actually be up on a sort of pedestals, so that you would be standing up looking down over the Phragmites into the river. So this would not be accessible from below, but from above. And then, of course, a boardwalk that gets to the river. So fairly simple scheme, fairly cost-effective scheme, keeps it open, keeps it lawn. You know, people can use it for games, for frisbee, you know, just another sort of open space that people can take advantage of. So those were the two wharf options. I'd be glad to entertain.
Oh, by the way,
there are plans A and B. Okay, the existing boardwalk down there, are they retained in either or both of those?
Yes, we were told that that's hands off, and I won't comment on that boardwalk.
Can I?
Yes, you can. You're the committee.
I think that's the biggest challenge to that site is what's been done there already. And I think that the angle, and I like, you know, if we had a bigger map, we could see this. I think it's more flatter angle here than no, I think it's...
this. It's somewhere in here, because I was out there this afternoon.
Okay.
Somewhere in there.
Yeah, see, I thought it was more. But, I mean, the essence of that walkway that's there now is that there's a 6 to 8 foot high fence.
Thank you.
Between the site and the river.
Yes.
I mean, that's what it's perceived as because of that.
There's a barrier.
Guardrail that's elevated 4 feet off the ground. And I think that's a big design issue. You know, I was really disappointed when I saw that because now there's this big barrier. You know, bought the property to have access to the river, and now... like, it's done the opposite. So,
I would not disagree with anything you just said.
Anything, you know, if that's sacred and cannot be touched, then anything that wants to take advantage of the view on that site needs to be elevated.
The buffer, the only thing sacred there is a 25-foot critical area buffer. On the fact this is a buffer-exempt area doesn't mean we're exempt from, you know, constructing that buffer. The fact that it's low right now has very little to do with its function as a buffer. It's not meant to be a marsh buffer. It's meant to, except on the other side where we created the living shoreline.
Mm-hmm.
On that side, if I would wager, if we either bulkheaded or filled that elevation up, but still preserve the filtration quality of the buffer that was intended to be there, you would satisfy, you would answer the mail. So there's more than one way to skin the cat. I completely agree. You're walking along and all of a sudden this thing hits you in the chest and you're looking over, trying to look over it at, but with the idea that the rest of the site could be elevated, certainly makes sense and actually would work better.
But
you're looking over it.
Could the fence come down?
What fence?
The railing.
A railing was there for a safety purpose. That was the purpose of that, because it's really pretty.
It's over 30 feet.
Oh, you're talking about the railing on the upside.
30
inches. Yeah. If you're talking about the railing on the inboard side, yeah, that could probably be modified if you filled the site or were able to fill the site. And in fact, this is IDA, and the purpose of the buffer is for filtration from the from whatever activities were there or would ever go there. So that's a landscaping issue, not a preserved existing elevation.
And there's two things to notice, two comments, I guess. I'm staying away from the railing and the boardwalk issue because I don't have much positive to say about it, and I don't want to step on anyone's toes. But I won't disagree with all of the comments that have been said. Two things. One, a lot of these schemes actually potentially are taking away a lot of impervious area. So I know that you were, you know, a lot of that impervious area that's there now was kept to deal with, you know, stormwater issues. Mm-hmm. So we're actually talking about taking a lot of that surfacing away. The parking lots can be done as such that they're pervious. So, you know, you look at that and you might say, well, there's a parking lot there. Well, we can do that so that it's semi-permeable. So I think, so a lot of that is taken away. The other thing with the buffer that you have there now is never going to work, because when you put trees in the ground, you have to have a medium that they can thrive and grow in. And I think what happened out there was that someone just came in and planted trees in the existing soil that was out there. Mm-hmm. The challenge of this site that this site has been basically an industrial site for 200 years, that there is no soil there. It's dirt, and it's dead. That means it'll never accommodate any significant plant communities. So anything that happens to this site is going to have, if you want it to be green, it's going to have some significant investment in soil remediation to get good soils in there to have the park be green. And that buffer that's there right now, it'll continue to decline. I would speculate, and I'd be willing to make a wager on it, that it'll continue to decline until you won't have a buffer anymore, because those plants just aren't going to live there. So until there's significant soil remediation, you're either going to be on the hook for some bond that you're bound to, or you're going to have to basically abandon the plantings. And when you start this park planting from scratch, you take another look at that buffer to after you remediate the soil.
I kind of like the logarithmic spiral, the chambered nautilus plan, because that one creates, we know that when we put the kayak launching ramp right next to that area, it makes a lot of sense for folks to be able to access a potential seasonal use right there. If you needed a quart of motor oil or you needed a hamburger, that's the place down in that lower corner where you'd be most likely to go to get it. Yes, ma'am.
Hi. I'm Jean Moore and I live in town. Mm-hmm. I noticed that each one of these plans has these pavilions here. And I'm not exactly sure in terms of where one would be standing to see out down the Corsica River, but I'm wondering whether these pavilions are going to be blocking the view. And the second thing is, could you make some of them available or of a size and attractiveness that they could be used for weddings?
Yeah, we talked, that was a good point.
That kind of
Glad
stuff.
You brought that up, because several folks in our walkabout mentioned having either an area in that lawn area that was designated for a tent stake down that would already be pre-bored, so that your vendor would bring the tent in and erect it on existing bases. So they wouldn't have to drive stakes in. Just set them up on the standard sizes, an array of existing standard sizes. We really talked about that. We know that without competing with a lot of the standard wedding venues that are around, we could create a budget product that would be usable for weddings. And that was part of the use of that open space. These smaller pavilions are too small for that, but they could be used as little side areas during that if somebody wanted to rent that space. And it certainly is, right now we rent out, if you want to call it that, the pavilion down at the Millstream Park for family cookouts and reunions and whatever, and you're able to do that. We never really envisioned the Millstream Park as a wedding venue. This we heard in our walkabout that this was the one that they really thought would be great for that. I'm glad you brought that up, because we hadn't mentioned that.
The pavilions, I mean, who knows what shape they're going to be, what configuration they're going to be, but the intent was that they would be fairly transparent, fairly light, and open. So they wouldn't necessarily block the view. I mean, if you were standing at a certain point, you know, they might, you know, mask some of the view. But also on this particular scheme, you'll notice this space right here. And that space was kind of designed with the thought that that would be kind of separate use space. So as Mike said, if you wanted to strap down the tent in there, you know, you're kind of separated from the other areas. The pavilions, I mean, there could be different size pavilions. We kind of drew them all at about a 15 by 15 pavilion. But there could be, you know, a 20 by 20 pavilion. There could be a 25 by 25 pavilion. We also tried to sort of distribute them throughout the site so that they wouldn't all be stacked up against one another, but they also had different kind of amenities associated with them. So, you know, here you're looking out on this part of the water, here you're looking, you know, straight down, you know, here you're looking on the side, which is west, west passage. Yeah. Sorry.
Mill Creek. The beginning of it.
The one thing, though, that about weddings is, two things. Parking, okay? You know, you picture the typical 100 to 160. How many cars is that? All right? And you already know you've got a parking problem down there. And the other is, again, is public use. To the extent that it can be a smaller wedding, a quicker wedding, you know, the town works out permitting so that it, you know, ceremony and reception can take place, but the public isn't barred from using the site, you see. I mean, this is one of the things about having this space. You have an amazing opportunity here that most communities across the entire Chesapeake Bay, three-state Chesapeake Bay region, do not have. And that is wonderful access, park access at the water site. It is possible to create something really wonderful for the town. How much do you want to share that with private events that exclude folks from the town, or may not? I mean, I think it's one of those, I'm looking at Steve, because it's one of these town administration issues, is how do you deal with, you know, public use and a private use that you want to encourage? I mean, obviously, we all want to be able to have, you know.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Which is a public beach, you know, and it was down at the Far End by Henlopen Hotel. Excuse me, thank you. It was down by the Henlopen Hotel, which is much less dense, and they do have a parking area right mm-hmm. there. And the florist came and put up a little, you know, mm-hmm. arch with
sure.
flowers and stuff on it. And wow. people just automatically kind of just, you know, stepped away
yeah.
and gave the wedding party their privacy, so to speak. I mean, if you can say they had any privacy.
Right. Yeah. And there's yeah. a difference between the ceremony and the reception and how you arrange all of that. And if it's a use that the community wants to have at the site, it can be accommodated. Mm-hmm. And I think that's part of this conversation. Is
we currently do
that
at the Conquest, at yeah. Conquest Beach. Yeah. That can also carry what the county runs mm-hmm. down on Land's End. Where there's public events and still, you know, public has access and it's still, you know, plenty private for a wedding. And with excess parking on the opposite side of the road, you know, the principals in the wedding may want to have the car right there, but there's nothing, certainly nothing wrong with walking across the street.
And one of the things that we heard during the walk and talk was the possibility perhaps, and I don't know his name, but there is a property owner across the river, you know, it's not that far, guys.
Yeah, on the farm, on the opposite side.
If there would be a way to work out with the farm property owner on the other side, some kind of overflow parking, some other kind of arrangement,
right.
Then you could get more larger events, more frequent events, perhaps, if you had that accessible. And that's something that we can write up as a recommendation, see if you can find alternate ways for parking. But mm-hmm. I'd like to step back with one point that I'd like to make. You can obviously tell I'm really invested in this site. I've loved this site from the moment you guys were so brave as a community to buy this property. It's just, you just deserve so much praise for having done that. Is how do you make this something that improves the quality of every person's life in this town? That every evening, if whether or not you can, it always occurs to you at sunset, I'd like to walk down there mm-hmm. and watch the sunset, you know, with other folks in town. Or I'd like to, you know, spend 2 or 3 days a week, I make a point of going to that park because it's so much part of my soul, my enjoyment of this community. How do we make this park do that for you? That's what we need all of us to be looking at.
One thing that I had hoped for here was integration of the plan for the park open space and the building that the town also owns. Mm-hmm. And if there's a way to combine a vision for all of that, including the tract across the street, the park that you've done some really cool things with, and the big building that we've got that it's rented up now, but that's not a 20-year use for that building. 20 years from now, when this park is realized, is there a way to do something cool with those two big buildings and integrate them into this as well?
Yeah, I agree, Jim. And when we looked at that, that was part of the issue because the Cornell Maritime Press building, the area of that was actually dedicated for parking for that was very nominal to non-existent. You could fill that up immediately if you just used one small portion of the upstairs conference room. You know, so yes, parking, adding that parking maybe on the opposite side of the road and then integrating that through also made a lot of sense. So when we looked at that parking plan to put 45 spaces on the opposite side of the road and the plan to move the parking so that it was accessible either, as you see in that plan, very close to the entrance, side entrance of that building. Yeah, those are options that can be used. We know with the interface with the county public landing, and the willy-nilly sort of parking that they do down there with the trailers kind of jams that area up. I mean, there's some pretty creative parking goes on down there when you have a big weekend. And it used to be that they would just park up and down Watson Road, just go all the way out, you know, to Spaniard Neck and just park in the ditch. And the county started, I think Steve can speak to that, when they were enforcing it with the county parks. Parks was actually enforcing that, trying to get people on those large weekends. We still have to honor the fact that that property is owned by the county and not by the town. We have to preserve, you know, that space because we can't use that for our own gratuitous purposes necessarily, you know, to accommodate what might be a full build out of that property. Yeah.
Just to add to that, I don't disagree with you one bit. I mean,
yeah.
You know, here was our magic line. You know, that's what we were charged to do. But in our walkthrough, I think we recognized, I mean, the county, you know, the county comp plan shows a trail that continues up to Chesterfield. And, you know, there are implications of that and limitations to actually making that happen because of land use. There's a private residence that's right on the water that basically stops. You know, ideally, there would be some, is this working? Yeah. Ideally, there would be some kind of promenade, you know, that would run all the way up the edge of the water and connect to Chesterfield. And this whole edge along this water would be one contiguously planned, you know, unit and work its way all the way around to this site. You know, unfortunately, you know, looking at these sites was beyond the scope of our work. But we totally agree with that, you know, comprehensively, I mean, we asked when we were on the walk, you know, if this private residence could be purchased by the town and that, because there's no way to get on the water. You know, that's a hole in the donut. I hope that is right. That person here.
I can see three effigies hanging from that one too.
Yeah.
if you did.
But
that,
you know, you want to talk bigger planning.
Yeah, you do.
You want to talk bigger planning and, you know, doing the right thing. I mean,
yeah,
that's
absolutely
what ideally would want to happen there. So
never gonna happen.
Right.
Well, I would just like to bring up the point that the town has, you know, just recently put these piers out here for rentable income
right.
to the town, which would, from anything I've heard and any of these plans, that's the only source of revenue that this town is going to be able to bring in is off of those slips. I actually rent one of those slips, and I'll tell you that I wouldn't want to have a parking lot at the top here and have to schlep down my three kids' gear, the swim, all of that stuff, and the coolers out to my slip that
She's
I rented.
To
you know, I mean, so I guess what I'm getting at is the idea of having parking here would satisfy both the town's desire to be able to have, you know, kind of close access to this pier, and then also the fact that we've got floating kayak launches in here. And then this parking lot being on this side also satisfies some of the parking that is gonna happen with the overflow, well, actually, you know, the parking that is gonna have to happen with this building that the town just purchased. And I think that combination with the parking across the street being, you know, more employee parking for that, you know, that building and the potential. And I do like the idea of being able to have this for events, and I think that overflow parking is a good idea. But I do like this sort of Nautilus idea, but it's almost like if we could just spin it just a little bit so we could consider the needs for the people who are going to be using the water and not just the park.
Right, sure.
And that's really what's getting, you know, that's what a lot of people are down there using it. They're fishing. That's sure. another thing, schlepping all the fishing poles and all that kind of mm-hmm. stuff.
And they're doing that now because the parking now. The parking is now right about there. Where right. the Nautilus right is.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, exactly. I mean, we yeah. put right up there and it's you know, okay. up the steps we go. So right. that's something else.
Oh, if you're in the county, yeah, if you're parking on the county property, yeah.
Yeah, but I mean, you know, again, we don't use the town property because mm-hmm. if we don't have a trailer, we've right. got to park in the town.
So now that conflicts with what I heard a little earlier about the boaters and the usefulness of having the pavilion, the sort of bait shop mm-hmm. Lemonade stand yeah. down in that corner. So that there's some trade-offs
yeah,
going on here,
right.
so that's good to hear.
Right.
So what, I mean
the other
more
thing
conversation?
With, the other thing with, you know, the bait shop being right there, I can see an argument for that. The other side of it is, you know, if we were going to maybe want to accommodate bathrooms or something like that, and I like that idea, is making it a little bit, having more access to, you know, Watson Road from a year-round standpoint, you know, would be a counter argument to it being right up against the water. I like the idea of the buildings being further away from the from the waterfront. The other thing that I see here, and you know, these pavilions are just, you know, if we're talking roughly 15 by 15 feet, I think that that's an interesting bird's eye view of it. But then I wonder about, you know, the actual feasibility of the uses of these little tiny pavilions, because the ones that are in the pocket parks now, I noticed that the larger pavilion of the two is the one where people will tend to congregate. You can get a picnic bench in there and they'll, you know, the kids will kind of go and hang out. But the other one that's smaller, the little gazebo one, like you don't see anybody in there because it's not really big enough to do
right.
anything.
Right. Mm-hmm.
You know, so I guess I would say, again, even though I here's like
better.
The sort of flow of this,
right.
you know, instead of having a bunch of these clustered around, would it make more sense to have fewer, a little bit larger, and maybe more strategically placed if we're going to think about accommodating concerts, weddings, you know, these kind of
family reunions,
I think that there's
yeah.
value to that. I mean,
oh, yeah.
I rented for my son's birthday the Millstream Park, and it
sure.
was great, you know. And if the wharf was available then, and there
you'd
were
done
shade
it, wouldn't you?
Trees, and it
yeah,
wasn't
right.
100 degrees out there, you know, that's
sure.
That's
good point.
That's a perfect place for it.
Steve, could I ask you about bathrooms? Where are we on the bathroom issue for that whole area? You're putting
downstairs
in,
off the lobby.
Yeah. Right. I'll hike all the way up here, right? Yeah.
The current situation with the bathrooms, we are applying for a grant to try to put the bathrooms on the interior of the building.
The large building, yeah.
But the time frame for that would be, I think the grant would not issue any award till like December, and we would not be doing construction till next spring.
Right.
And that's the inside of the larger building, the big building?
The office building.
Oh, the office building. Mm-hmm. Okay. Inside?
Yes.
Would it have
where the office space is currently located.
So
not,
would
not,
it?
Not the side of the building that used to be like a cafe.
Okay, so would it? So on the back side, or the Watson
side,
Road
side,
Watson
Road
side,
right?
Yes. And so would it be 24-hour access?
Hope not.
Seasonal.
I would envision that the town would probably not have it 24 hours.
Mm-mm.
I mean,
okay.
The 24 hours is the facility have seasonally down on the county facility. So I would think we would have the town facilities, you know, locked at, you know, some hour in the evening.
Right. Maybe coincident with the
yeah,
with
like,
the park's
like,
operating
like dark,
hours or
yeah,
whatever. Yeah,
park closed at dark, that type of thing.
But the answer seems to be that we don't have to assume that bathrooms would go into another structure that would go into the park.
That would
not
be,
necessarily.
That would be one possible assumption. Yes.
Okay. All right. I mean, we don't have to program that structure, but it's
don't have to. But again, when you look long term,
yeah.
it could be, you know, another one of those things where.
Makes sense.
You know, grant pays for it, but 10 years down the road, you have other uses that you could have for the building, and you could put bathrooms out in the park somewhere. You know, with some of the prefab structures they have today, that's still a, you know, a viable option, you know, down the road.
Sure. Any other comments from the committee or the public?
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
Justin,
in the interest of feedback, I liked option two, and because of the parking being at off of Watson Road directly, if there is a concert there, an event, anything that's trying to gather a bunch of people to that nice amphitheater, it would have two different parking areas, three different if that is a parking lot across the road, and that would help control the flow. So I like that aspect. People are already parking over in the big parking lot to schlep their stuff to their boats at the slips anyway, and if they parked in the parking lot right off of Watson, that's really a quick walk.
It's not.
Down.
It's not, Denise.
Trust me. Well, I'm going 1 mile an hour, and it's a pretty quick walk.
Yeah, but if you had to pick him up and drag him across, that's the equivalent
of traveling
with your
kids. Don't weigh 180 pounds.
But the coolers and the food and everything else does, trust me.
Yeah, that's going to the bus for sure, yeah.
Just noting, I liked that several options to Watson Road as opposed to only one parking area or all the parking flowing into that other big lot going out onto Watson Road.
And I agree
and
with
the
you
section
too.
Across the street, I do like extra parking and all of that and a little green space. And in either spot, just because I am kind of dog-centric, in either this spot or at Railroad, if there's an open space, how about a dog park? There's some over on Kent Island, which I still haven't found, but we don't have any really local. Right. Fenced in, appropriate dog play.
Well, it's interesting you ask. I'm the chairman of the Centreville Parks Board, by the way. And and one of the things that we have looked at was creating a dog park between Center Park, the Gravel Run, and the railroad track down on Little Hut Drive. That was one of the areas. It was perfectly suited. It has great topography for it. And that was also the area where the trailhead, where I was just mentioning earlier, the potential vehicular parking area for the trailhead. Put the cars over on the jail side of the railroad track, because that's pretty secure. At least you have police looking at it five times every three minutes. And then down on the opposite side, on the 2 acres that is on the south side of the tracks, would be an area where we would create a dog park. It's something we've been thinking about at the Parks Board. Yeah.
That spot across the wharf, acreage-wise, how much is that? I just don't have I see it all the time, but I don't know what. Is that 2 acres?
Not quite 2 acres.
Okay.
Yeah, it's not suited for a dog park.
But what's that, Elizabeth?
Why do you think? That site there.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. But, if you've been, when you get to a dog, you'll see so much fencing with a dog park. Well, you're the designer.
I don't know that I'd necessarily, I'd respectfully probably disagree with that. I mean, I think a dog park can go in either one of these facilities. It would just need to be designed for it, you know, with, like you said, the appropriate fencing. So whether or not, you know, now I will say that someone might go crazy about a dog park here because of the water runoff into the river and of the feces. And even though dog owners are respectful and they pick up their pet's feces in most instances, I could tell you someone from the environmental group is going to lash out at the idea of a dog park probably being this close to an environmental area,
so maybe
potentially on the wharf site as well.
The dog park that we were talking about would be graded with aggregate material that is washed down into a holding pond and treated before it's discharged to the stream.
So
that's actually the way it has to be done, yeah.
It doesn't look that far away from an actual prison yard. Like, I mean, those dogs, like, destroy those, and then it's surrounded by a chain link fence. I don't think either one of these sites would actually
That's why we were looking at the little hut.
I think that's a perfect idea.
Well, and actually, it needs to be big enough that they don't wear them out.
Right,
I guess.
Yeah, but, I mean, they're big areas.
But I before you sit down, and you already did, Miss, is that you live on Chesterfield Avenue. One of the things that's part of the thinking here is that the Parks Board has drawn a trail all the way up to town, kind of behind and beside the water.
On the Chesterfield Farm side, all the way around Chesterfield Farm, tying back out to allow us at some point to loop that entire section. So coming from, for example, from the switchback that he was showing there, with adjacency to the development, if there is development on the Chesterfield Farm side, to require that as part of the park proper, that connectivity be made, allow you to make a secondary loop back into the parks from the outside, which would be a great way to do it. And you know, it's
it's in our plan and it's in our master plan.
And this becomes a trailhead for that. I mean, if you think of the park a different direction, looking back toward how do you connect back to town. I guess I did hear one comment between the walk and talk and now, and that was someone who was absolutely horrified at the idea that the Watson Road parcel, the one that's up now, would be paved and have parking. So I think that's a challenge to you all if you all feel that the parking is good, and especially from the committee advising us as we try to go forward with this plan. What do we say about that? What is the Corsica River Conservancy?
I'll tell you what you say about it is that that in our lifetime that had farm equipment on it, solid, about twice the size of its current size. Do you remember it's used for farm equipment storage down there when Agrico was there?
They stored fertilizer equipment.
Yeah, stored fertilizer on it. It is not. It is not what you could call pristine. You know, never carried impervious duty in its past.
We'll get that old picture and put it in the report.
Well, you know, here's the thing about it is this is free market, and that market that property was on the sale or was on sale for how many years? And if somebody really thought that it was worth, you know, buying and preserving, then you know, at some point in time, you got to say put your money where your mouth is. Otherwise, you know, we've got to utilize it for something, you know. And again, parking is like the one thing down there that's just like, oh, we'd love to do this. Oh, but there's not enough parking. So, I mean, the town purchasing this parcel sort of just, you know, answers that question for us.
I would just say from a historic perspective that piece of property has changed significantly over the last 150 years. It was not originally like that. Mm-hmm. Was a much more stable piece of property. There was a house there and so forth, but there's been so much that has happened there that it's just not the same piece of property anymore.
Right. And Watson Road was realigned to flatten out the curve, and when we did that, that actually pushed that slope further out toward the river. And all those individual properties that were given the option to pick up that surplus property when the road was relocated.
Okay, we're getting the high sign that it is 9:00.
There wasn't all that fragmented.
And I didn't hear, and I'd like to prompt someone from somewhere to talk about just very briefly as a goal here that the net value to the Corsica River be increased by whatever happens on this site. Do I understand that that's a goal here?
That would be nice.
Okay, all right, I needed to hear that. I'm looking at you especially, all of you people. You live in the most wonderful town and you've loved the Corsica and done some amazing things. So net value to the Corsica is that this site, no matter what happens on it, you gain value to the Corsica from this, right? Okay, all right.
Public access to water is the highest premium in this state right now. And as I said before, I believe of the 154 municipalities in the state of Maryland, that Centreville probably has the longest continuous frontage of tidal water that it owns and proprietarily maintains of any of them. Yeah, just think about it.
Yes.
You know. Yeah, the college owns it, or private people own it. St. Michael's, they have a very small strand now. The town of Oxford, the strand is privately owned, even though it's sort of quasi-publicly used. Easton has nothing at Easton Point.
Cambridge, you know, and Chrisfield?
Cambridge and all of them. You name them. They're, we've got it.
Cambridge and Chrisfield gave away
their. We're talking about
the
mill stream going all the way up to 213 and beyond. The tidal water coming all the way around Mill Stream Trail, all the way around. To the end of that is just an amazing asset to this town. Unbelievable piece of reference.
Okay, well
thank you all.
Thank you very much.
Thank you all for serving.